Okay, good evening. Welcome to our service tonight. Great to see you all with us. All right, would you stand, please? All right, just a couple of things to remind you about. Friday night, there will be a candlelight service here beginning at 7:30. Candlelight service here, 7:30. Saturday morning, there will be an outreach meeting, and those who are not spending the day or Christmas Eve with their families or something, there will be an outreach on Saturday morning. So you're welcome to be a part of that on Saturday morning. Also, if you want to invite somebody to Friday night's candlelight service, there are special invitations that are available at the Welcome Center for you to take and give to your neighbors and friends on that. And then on Sunday, Christmas Day. You'll hear more about this later in the service about the homeless outreach with Pastor Dan Sergione at 8 o'clock on Sunday morning. At 11 o'clock, there will be a service here, but there will not be a children's program. That parents, you need to know that. That's at 11 o'clock, and at 6:30 in the evening, there will be a service as usual here on Christmas night. Okay? All right. And Monday is a holiday for the campus, so there won't be anything happening on the 26th of December here. You got it all? Everyone understand that? Because there's been some confusion, and I'm trying to clear it up. All right, okay, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your blessing on us tonight. We just thank you for this season of the year. We just ask you to cover us now and lead us, help us to focus, to concentrate on your word to us tonight. We thank you for gathering us together, Lord, to worship you. We're just excited about hearing the word of God this time. In your name, amen.
Good evening. How are you? Amen. Let's start the evening off. Just speak a word of praise to the Lord. Just say something to the Lord if you feel led. Just think on the Lord, praise the Lord, worship the Lord. No distractions. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. Thank you, God.
We will love and adore. He is high.
appeared a star, while angels sang to the lowly shepherd. Three wise men bent seeking truth, traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven. Falling on their knees, they bowed before the humble Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering to you. Cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. And it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering. Worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering to you.
The greatest wonder.
God so loved the world that he sent his only son, and he came to this earth and he walked amongst men, and he taught, and he preached, and he died on the cross for us, that we could be here tonight raising our hands to heaven, and we could say that there is no other name by which man could be saved. There's no other name that we could find joy and peace. There's no other name that we could find life. We could find courage and hope. It's the name of Jesus. In This season we celebrate the birth of our Savior, His life. So Father, we raise our hands to You tonight and we just say glory to You, God, in the highest. And we praise You and we worship You. And we say, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord, worthy to be praised. This is what we can do. We may not have a song in our heart, but we can raise our hands and we can say, thank You, Jesus. He is here. He is with us. He is for us. Our Savior, our King. Thank You, God. Oh, Lord, move through this congregation tonight. Touch every heart here, God. Speak to us. We need You, Lord. Father, we pray for our church. We pray for our pastor. We pray for our country. We pray for this world, Lord. This world needs You. And we are Your people, Your children. We are Your voice. And we thank You. We praise You. Can you praise the Lord right now? Can you just praise Him? That's right. Applaud Him. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Lord, bless this night. Receive our praises, God. In Your holy name we pray. Amen.
All right, good evening. Merry Christmas. Say Merry Christmas to your neighbor. Yeah. Say Happy Hanukkah to this. No. No. Merry Christmas. All right. Right now, we'd like to welcome anyone who's here for the first time. So if you're a guest with us tonight, raise your hand. We have a card we'd like to give you. Anyone here tonight for the very first time? Right there. Thank you. Right down front here. Thank you for being with us. Keep your right there in the middle there, too. Thank you. Thanks for being with us. And if you have any questions about what goes on in our church, you can talk to someone at the Welcome Center. There's a lot of information on that card also. And thanks for being here at this time. Now, Pastor Dan Sergioni is going to tell us about the homeless outreach on Christmas morning.
Good evening. Okay, so here we have Christmas again, and we're going to go out again. And I'm going to give you my phone number here so you can call me if you can help out. I've been between houses for the last 2 months, so I've got stuff all over the place, so it's been a little difficult for me with Thanksgiving and Christmas this time. So I really think at the end of this year, God's going to do some amazing miracles. And this is the end of the year, and I really want Him not only to save but to deliver many of these people downtown. And I know you do. And it's like the more that can come out from our church, the more impact we have, if you can. And you can bring your children again. I think with children seeing what's going on downtown, it really gives them an insight of what our church is all about. We have so many outreaches. This is, again, only one, but it gives them a chance. It's safe down there. We have security. And it gives them a chance to talk to people, and it breaks them when they hear little children giving them gifts, giving them things. It really breaks them. So if you can come out, let me give you a phone number now. It's 410-624-9955. And if you didn't get that, you could call the missions and get that number. But I'd like you to call it. And if you can help out or if you can volunteer anything, please do so. This is going to be the best Christmas outreach we've ever had. This is going to be the best because I think more are going to come out to church. And we've had several that came out Thanksgiving, some that wanted to come, didn't quite make it. And so we call them all up, that we get numbers from them and invite them out. Okay? So thank you so much.
Okay, so you don't want to forget your Grace Hour envelopes tonight. $5 or whatever you can give it would be great just to keep our broadcast on the air. in the sort of the digital age we live in, we've gotten a lot of requests about some sort of easy way to give in the offering from our mobile phones, okay? And we actually have had that facility in place for some time. I think maybe some people just don't know about it. And I'm not the most technologically backward person, but I'm also definitely not on the cutting edge either. So what I did yesterday is I went to ggwo.org/M. Okay, I think the M stands for mobile, okay? And I went there and I created an account for myself and I put in my information, you know, name, address. I put my credit card number in there and Paul Nye assures me my credit card is safe and will not be hacked by the Russians. Boy. And I also... when I was in there at that place, not only can you give there, but you can also listen, you know, sort of online from your mobile phone. There's more there than just giving, okay? And, of course, we want it to be very easy if you give from your mobile phone. So I was going to do a live demonstration right now to show you how easy it is, and I sure hope it works, okay? So... don't go yet, Seb. We're almost there. Not yet. But Seb's going to, when I tell him to go, he's going to put the clock up. And when I hear the music, I will start giving. And then Seb, when I say, you know, when I hold up my phone, I'm done, then make sure you stop it so we get an accurate reading. Okay? So we're just about ready. Not quite yet here. My phone's in my pocket, and I'm going to draw as soon as I hear the music. Okay, Seb, go. Seb, stop. That was a total disaster, okay? I did not successfully give, and I think maybe it's because of the Wi-Fi in here isn't good. What? Where is Paul? Where is he? Pete, anybody? I'm so embarrassed about this. Okay, I swear to God, I did it in 24 seconds yesterday. And I just, it's come up this far. It's got Greater Grace World Outreach, but it's not getting to the next step here. So maybe you're all praying against me to make a fool of myself. Anyway, shucks. It really does work. I was going to give $25 because that's five times what I normally give, the five. Okay, you'd like that. So anyway, God, please put me out of my misery tonight. Bless this offering, and bless our technology, we pray in your name. Amen.
Okay, let's take a, that's the Bible College Choir, by the way. There. So take a moment now, and you know, if someone near you or in your seat by yourself, just to take a few moments to pray, prepare your heart for our message tonight.
Lord, we are gathered in your name. Your Spirit feeds us that we are not wasting our time tonight, but receiving the engrafted word that is able to change, able to quicken, heal, renew our minds, encourage us, comfort us. We are redeeming time, applying ourselves to the important things. We are renewed. We have been saved. We are regenerated. We have a capacity for you and worship you, like the wise men who sought you and found you and worshiped you. And gave to you, worshiped and gave. Bless this season, our coming new year, and our whole, the Holy Spirit's work in every heart, that we would have a new birth in prayer, new birth in our devotion, new birth in our vision, new enthusiasm in our lives, that you would renew our youth like the eagle. And in saving, you save, you really deliver. You really deliver. Thank you, Lord, for coming into this world. It is extraordinary, and the effect is extraordinary. Thank you, Lord. Bless these minutes together in our learning and our applying in our hearts to what we hear. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Wow. You see, the before we start our sermon, cafe cards, Faith Jones, she's right there. She's back from college. Yeah. Her sisters sang up here tonight. Did you see them? Esther and Rosalind, and this is Faith, the greatest of the three. We love you. Thank you. She's amazing. Hi, Daryl, Cynthia. Then I've got Jeff Harrington. How about you, Pastor Jeff? Right over here. Sirpa Anderson. How about it, Sirpa? James Carper, right here. The greatest of the Carpers. And then Crystal from Cherry Hill. Crystal, right? From Camden or Cherry Hill? Yeah. Yeah, you. Thank you, Sirpa. James, Pastor Jeff, we love you. Oh, that looks like there's a check in there. Wow. God bless you. Good to have you. Okay. Up on the introduction to the message is up on the screen. We have the country of Norway. Right here, this one, if you can see, it's kind of dim, but it goes from way up here, touching Russia. Let's see if I get my pencil. How do I get my pencil? Oh, wait a minute. This one? Okay. Great, thank you. Can you see that? Yeah, okay. Touch is Russia here. This is Norway here, right? Okay. This is the... Okay, so 18, let's see, 17, no, about maybe 90, maybe earlier, to 1814, I believe. This is an era in history where I've been reading a little bit about God's work in Europe at different times and what God did. And I just want to tell a simple story about a Norwegian farmer. And his name was Haug. I don't know how you would say it, but this is his name. Illiterate, there were no railroads in Europe at this time. People traveled by ox cart, wagons, sleighs, and horses. They walked. This farmer, very far away from God, the church was and is Lutheran, and the rules were there was no preaching without an official Lutheran priest present. If you did, you could be imprisoned. This farmer was born again. This is an important point. He was saved by God's grace. The Spirit moved in him, and he was moved in his heart to study the Bible, quote the Bible, memorize the Bible, and preach the Bible. And he did it. And he was on fire. And he got in trouble for it. But he would travel from village to village preaching, and people were drawn to him because that's what happens when you are Spirit-filled, when God has anointed you in your life and you have a message. Now, about in the same period, I'll tell a little bit more about him, but in Sweden, there was a similar thing that happened here, and this is like the Bible Belt in Sweden. There's actually a Bible Belt in Sweden. It's the western coast and swinging down south. This is where Ulla's from.
And so, Ula, you want to say amen? Amen. Yeah, she, a Bible believer, her dad, her mom, Bible believers in Sweden. But there was a priest who was on fire. His name was, Shartau, T-A-U. And the peasants would come and hear him preach. And some of the peasants, they would walk as far as 50 miles. And they were nicknamed half-soled because their shoes would wear down because of walking so far. And they walked so far just to hear a message from a man who had the Spirit of God moving in him. Now, in the same period, the churches were somehow empty and dead. Because in Europe, there was the Enlightenment period, the unbelief, the atheism of Voltaire, the Enlightenment. And the principle has not changed through history. There is the work of the world and the message of the world that doesn't satisfy. And then there is the Spirit of God that moves, that speaks to people and changes things. Now, this Norwegian man traveled from Tromsø, and this is up here. We had a summer harvest team, or I don't know if we actually did it. We had a plan to do it from Finland, and we actually did do Bergen. We had a team there one summer. Pastor Krama went, and we did preaching and ministering in Norway that summer in 1979. But this farmer, get the picture, walking, traveling by cart, preaching wherever he could go, and then running in the opposition and being imprisoned 14 times. I believe they estimated he walked 27,000 miles. He was moved. He wrote a book about every year. He wrote one or two books. And I believe the Norwegians read, though, I read there were 900,000 literate Norwegians at the time, and 100,000 of them had read his one book or his books. I think he had written 33 of them. It moves me, the story. It moves me. I love to think about that. And I want to share a short message about it from Acts chapter 12. So turn there with me, please. Let's preface this with Acts 26. So turn there and read that portion with me. The Apostle Paul is said, he tells the story of his conversion. He said, Jesus, he spoke to Paul. I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for you to kick against the pricks. And I said, who are you, Lord? He said, I am Jesus, whom you persecute. Rise, stand upon your feet. I have appeared unto you for this purpose, to make you a minister. Who made him a minister? Jesus made him a minister. Who made this Norwegian farmer a preacher? And it said that he would farm, he would plow the field of a local farm with the farmer before he would preach his message. Because he was not after their money, and he wasn't lazy, but he was there to serve them. He would plow a field, then he would go and preach, and people would get saved and changed by his ministry. So much it affected the whole country. One man called, one man on fire, one man who has a, who's called to be a minister, one man, one woman. That's a great story. So I say it by way of inspiration and just thoughtfulness tonight. Because I believe if God so loved the world that he came as a babe, he wouldn't stop there. That if he came into Bethlehem as a humble servant, he wouldn't stop there. This holiday has no end. This holiday is simply celebrating what is obvious, that God did something extraordinary, and so he did in Norway with this man who, when he was in prison, would not stop. And sometimes he would go to a Lutheran church, and after the priest would do his ministry, he would preach outside. And he would do it out of love and care for people, because he saw how the alcoholism, how the hatred, how the vengeance, how the adultery, how the wickedness of man's heart keeps him in bondage. Read the rest of it, verse 16. I appeared unto you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness both of these things which you have seen and of the things with which I will appear unto you. Now, a lot can be said, but I can't stay there. I realize that's loaded, but look at verse 17. Delivering you from the people, from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Now, that's powerful. That's what we're doing. That's what is happening. People turn from Satan to God. All of the cultural trappings that we have in our country, whether it's Hollywood and the movies, iPads, iPhones, technology, communications, sexual revolution, fornication, Satanism, drugs, addiction, whatever. And my wife read a statistic to me in West Virginia. There have been the distribution of 762 million Oxycontin pills or oxycodone pills that are prescription medications that have gone to a state, West Virginia, of 1.8 million people. It calculates 462 pills per person in West Virginia. What do you think? Do they need to have some power come that turns them from Satan to God, from darkness to light, from their own life to Christ's life, from their way to God's way? Do you think that God would put his hand upon his people and send us, and we would have a ministry, and that ministry would be nothing less than an absolute change in the life of a person? That's what I believe has happened through history. You could visit Norway back in those years and say, not going to happen. People live far away. They live on farms. Back in Finland, I remember this revivalist, similar thing. Lestardius was his name. He was a Lutheran priest in the north part of Finland, and the sleighs would come in. And around his church, there was a path where he would walk every day praying for revival, praying for the Spirit to move in the area, praying for people to come to the church and hear about Christ. And it was something about it, a magnetism, a spirit, the Spirit of God that draws people. If the elephants could find Noah's Ark, people can find our church. If a monkey can get in the ark, then somebody in Rosedale can get in here. Right? Or the university of whatever, they could show up. Oh, yeah, that's it. That's what I want to say tonight. That's what I believe in. I believe that it's covered with prayer. Now let's go to the story. Acts chapter 12, please. In other words, the birth of that baby is the evidence of what we're saying. Now, Norway, Sweden, there are revival histories of revivals in Hungary, Germany, France, revival works in the states of Kentucky and Tennessee. When there were when the pioneers went there, they were drunk, they were negligent, they were disorganized, sometimes just one level above a barbarian, throwing their wives away and their kids and could care less. And then what happened? The Methodist preachers showed up. The pietism of the 18th century, the Spirit of God moving in the hearts and minds of men and women, same in the 21st century. I could care less about what is happening out there. I know they are hungry. I know they are thirsty. I know they would wear out their shoes to come and hear a message and have something in it where they can leave and say, by the grace of God, I want what he's preaching about. By the grace of God, I want Christ in my life. If Christ came to Bethlehem, then he can come to me. If Christ could take an alcoholic and transform him and give him a new joy and a new hope and a new answer. If James Bryson, sitting in a prison one day woke up and said, oh God, I cry out to you. And God heard from heaven and answered the cry of the prisoner and sent him here and made a disciple out of him. And he's a missionary that travels here and there in the highways and byways of life. Okay, now follow the story. Acts 12, we could go to the one verse. I want to read the story a little bit, but before we get to I want you to look at 18, verse 18. Now, as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers. What was become of Peter? You see it? No. What about Peter? Peter was in jail. He had 16 state troopers hooked up to him. He had 16, what's the word there in the text? Quaternions. It means a team of four soldiers. And there were four of those teams. That means four times four, 16 soldiers chained. Doors closed in prison, and he disappears. And the soldiers say, where'd he go? That's here, verse 12. Go back to 18 for me. 12. Now, as soon as it was day, there was no small servant. What was become of our Norwegian farmer here? Where did he go? Where did that Norwegian farmer go? He's a nobody. Oh, no, he's gone. Where'd he go? He went after God. God is with him. God delivered him out of the jail. God delivered him out of alcohol and oxycodone and oxycontin and any other oxy that's addictive. Where'd he go? He left. He left the beer hall. Where'd he go? I don't know. He dropped everything. He left. He's gone. What happened to him? The power of Christ. The same thing. What happened in Bethlehem. What happened on that Christmas morning. What happened with the manifestation of the Almighty God that came here and said, I love you so much, I become one of you. It's a beautiful story about a pastor in Europe who, I think he was Norwegian, actually. He went to the Polynesian Islands were to a leper colony, and he poured out his whole life there, and he worked with the lepers, and he didn't get sick, and he served them and did ministry and preached Christ to them and led them. And then one day he said to the congregation, he said, we lepers. And what he was saying was, I have it now. I am a leper too. I have contracted the disease. We lepers, that's like Jesus. He became a sinner. He became like us so that the people of Norway would see a light shining. That somebody who's in prison all wrapped up and we got him. It's like the devil's saying, we got him. And then one day they'll go, where'd he go? The devil says, we had him wrapped up with the women and we got him wrapped up with the lies and the skepticism and the fear and the unbelief. We had him chained up, everything all tight and secure. And where'd he go? You know what happened? God delivered him. God changed his life. Plucked him out, snatched him, saved him. I'm encouraged tonight. I really am. I'm thinking about prayer. I'm thinking about the Spirit in the year 2017. I'm thinking about what we talk about, what we represent. I'm thinking about the radical attitude of like saying, no, I don't accept it. Yeah, but he says, yeah, but I'm all chained up. I can't get out of here. There's no way. No, I don't accept it. I believe we have the power to turn people from Satan to God. No, Satan will say, no, you don't have the power. We say, Bethlehem says we have the power. The resurrection says we have the power. The ascension says we have the power. The Spirit coming to us says we have the power. The Bible says we have the power. The Bible said, the church says we have the power. That's what we're talking about. And they said in Norway, they would have, in Sweden, they would have these messages about agriculture and about different subjects and about health and food and different things that they talked about in those days. And what did the people say or do? Oh, what do you have to say to me? I can find that out in the marketplace. What do you have to say to me? I can get that at the university or at a school. What do you have to say to me? Do you have any message? And we are saying, yes, we do. Let's read the text. It says in chapter 12, verse 1, now about that time, and put in Herod's name, Satan stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. Satan wants to get his grubby hands on us. Yes, he does. And he's really powerful. He can do a lot of damage and a lot of hurt. But now, hey, it can't happen until the time. I'm not afraid of terrorism because it can't happen until it's the time for me. God has a time for me, and whatever the time is, that's fine. He leads us unto death, Psalm 48:14. Isn't it true? What do you fear? We fear nothing. We fear God. We fear missing our calling. We fear missing the whole point of life. We fear being ashamed at the Bema seat. We fear like missing the target. No, we don't care about these things. Verse 2, and he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. But don't fear him who, after he kills you, can't do any. Remember, you know those people, after they kill you, they grind you up in a grind. They try to do even more. Try all you can. You can't do more. You can only kill my body and destroy my body, but you cannot cast my soul into hell. Nor can you utterly destroy my body, for in Philippians 3:20, that glorious resurrection by the same power that raised Christ from the dead, well, more it will grace our bodies too, and we will be like him. Verse 3, because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Have you gotten a picture of spiritual warfare this past year? Have you seen spiritual warfare happening in our country? Do you see spiritual warfare happening in your life? Do you see a spiritual warfare? And it pleased some people to see our demise or annihilation. And when he saw it pleased them, he proceeded to take Peter also. than were the days of unleavened bread. When he had apprehended him, he put him in prison. And that's just what the devil's doing to the people in West Virginia, putting him in prison. Oh, I'd love to go there. Wouldn't it be fun? Go out the street, meet the pastors and encourage them. I say, please preach the message of grace. Please preach the word. Please fill the hearts and minds of people with Christ. Christ will pluck them out. Christ will change them. They'll get off the drugs in a minute if God wants it to happen, just like he did in this story. Read it with me. Verse 4, when he put him in prison, delivered him to 16 of these fine soldiers to keep him. But the devil assigns your friends to you. He assigns, remember, hang up the phone, Eric, that we made a big deal about here in our church. Remember, Eric, hang up the phone. I told him to hang up the phone. Remember? And I haven't seen him for a while because I think he's answering the phone. Hang it up. 16 soldiers are around this guy to keep him. Make sure you don't lose that drug addict. Make sure you don't lose that guy that's hanging out in the bar hall. Make sure you don't lose that fornicator on the college campus. Make sure you don't lose that guy that's addicted to whatever it is that he's chained to. And that's like us. We understand it. Yeah. And he was going to kill him after Easter, right? To keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, is kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. A few words about prayer. It's easy to neglect it. I don't know what happens to our minds, but we, by our nature, we don't, you know, do I need it? I need it. I know I do, but do I neglect it? Is it, can you get out of the habit? Could you get out of the routine of it? Could you get out of the fervency of it? Could you leave or lose the prayer in private, the communion, the spirit in you moving, spirit moving? I think if we go into this year, if we were to talk about anything, we could say, this happened because the church was praying and they didn't even know it. And when he was set free, they couldn't believe it. And in a way, I think prayer is something, I don't know how to explain it, but it's very much neglected. But it's okay. Let's, get refreshed in it. Don't worry about it. You just say, okay, I know about it. I know what it is. I want to wait on God and expect from God and stir up myself and believe that prayer, this is a powerful thing. Peter isn't it? No way of getting out. No way of the people in Norway changing their ways. No way of the guys drinking in Kentucky and Tennessee back in those early 1800s. No way they're going to ever change their way. But this is what happened. The preachers came. They got woke up. They got delivered. They had camp meetings. They would go before harvest time. They would go out. They were ready to their fields. They got at a certain time in their agricultural calendar. I don't know how it worked exactly, but a certain time they had a break where they could take some time and all gather together at a camp meeting. They did it by the ocean here in Maryland, over by Bethany Beach, all along up in Cape Cod, Methodist camps for the summertime. They were Methodists. They had a big impact. Spiritual revival. The Lutherans in Minnesota and those areas. The Baptists in the South. All of it. We have these amazing stories. And what it is, Peter, where did he go? Where did he go? I had that drug addict in my clutches. Where did he go? You can't find him, devil. He's gone. The ministry did it. Christ did it through the ministry. I give you power, Paul, to turn people from Satan to God, darkness to light. I have turned them. And we say, Jesus, really? And he goes, come on, I became a baby. I identified. I became a leper. I became a sinner. I died on the cross so that you could go free. I need you to preach. I need you to share. I need you to counsel. I need you to open your mouth. I need you to have a prayer meeting. I need you to wait on God. I need you to have a word in wisdom. I need you to have a local assembly. I need you to gather all the more as you see the day approaching, because I'm not done yet. I'm in the business of saving souls. I'm not done yet. I heard hundreds of Syrians in Germany coming to Christ. We hear about the terrorism, but we hear the devil in the background going, where did he go? Where did he go? I lost another one. I had him in chains. I had people around him. I had the prison doors shut. I had the King Herod himself responsible for his captivity. Where did he go? I cannot find him. And that happened to you and me at different times. I remember on the college campus, I was with a bunch of guys, and then I was gone. And they're saying, where'd he go? Where'd he go? And there was like two sides to that. Where'd he go? We like to get our hands on him. And the other side is, you let him go. We don't need him. Get him away from us. He could be dangerous. We don't want to talk to him anymore. We don't want to hear about his God and his crazy conversion or salvation. Let him go. We don't need him, but we can't lose any more. Well, this is a word. We've decided that we're going to get more. We are. We've decided that in our hearts. We're going to get more. And we're going to pray for it. Look at what they did. It says here, the church didn't cease to pray to God for him. When Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. I mean, there's an army. He's got two hooked up to him. Two of them hooked up right tight. Two drug dealers with him. He's got two women with him. He's tied up real tight. Remember Augustine, one of our church fathers, a young man running around with women? He had that habit. And then he just got saved, and he turned away. And one time he saw one of the women in the market, and he just ran the other way. He wanted to stay away from her and them as much as possible. But in his heart, deep inside, he was delivered. He was chained. He was changed. But yet one day he was chained to it. Have you been chained to your sin? Chained to it, you can't change. Chained to it, you can't shake it. Good news for you. Jesus came for you. He did. It's over. It's over. Hallelujah. It's over. Hallelujah. We are free. It's over. Hallelujah. I'm out. Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Can't find him, can you? He's gone. Then he goes, behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and the light shined in the prison. He smote Peter on the side. I think he gave him a good swift punch because Peter was sleeping. Rise up quickly, his chains fell off from his hand. I think sometimes people sitting in this congregation need a good swift punch to this side. May the angel of God smite you, and wake you up, and realize that what's being said is important and powerful and valuable and life-changing, and build your life on what God is saying. Wake up, awake thou that sleepeth. Rise from the dead, Christ shall give you light. Peter is sleeping, and all this is happening. He's going, what, what, What? And then as he goes out through the door, remember? He said, I don't know if I'm dreaming this or this is reality. That's a great statement. Let's read it. Verse 9. He went out, followed the angel, that did not know that it was true, which was done by the angel, but he thought it was a vision. He didn't know. Verse 11. Now when Peter was come to himself, he said, now I know the Lord has sent his angel. But before that, he didn't know. It's happened to me. I've been in the Spirit, been in the congregation, been in a conference in Europe. I go back home, and it's like, whoa, man, And I go, which was reality? Eurocon or this? What's reality? Baltimore Church, Baltimore Fellowship, or this drudgery that I'm living in? Which is true? Answer is, both are. You have both natures. You have both going on. But here's the word. Don't you live your life without this one. Don't live your life without the angel smiting you and saying, something good is going on. Wake up and smell the roses. Don't live your life without a prayer meeting that says, hallelujah, God is in the prayer. God is answering us. God is a mighty God. We shall do valiantly. Let us live our life like not saying, oh, you know, nothing will change. This is the same old, same old. No, mind renewal and vision and love. Okay? That's it. What a joy. Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Go ahead, say that to your neighbor. Theatrically, have a good time. Where'd he go? Say it, put it on. Act the part. What? Where'd he go? Where'd he go? I can't find him. Where'd he go? It's impossible that he would go. It is impossible that he is out of here. No. Just ask in Norway what happened. As people turn to Christ, ask in Sweden, ask in Finland, ask in Kentucky, and then, by the way, right here in our hometown of Baltimore City, God sent us here to do a work, to have an impact. 100 guys off the street, no more drugs, 100 men in Bible college, no more fooling around. I got something going on. I'm paying attention to it. I'm on a vision. We'll send you to Haiti, Africa, Norway, back to Europe where they need men and women of God. And send them into the highways and byways, into the Midwest, out there in the Mississippi region out there in the Midwest of the U.S. of A. or wherever, to Chicago, St. Louis, Missouri, Ohio River Valley, way out there, Salt Lake City, and even all the way to California. Hey, God's word, and if they already got it, let's go where they haven't heard it, and let's bring it with all our hearts, because we got the power from Christ. Amen. Would you pray with me? Lord, we believe the devil is wondering where we went. And even some of the friends of the past are still wandering around the old same bar room, the same routes, same parking lots and places. And wondering where we went. He got religion, I guess. I don't know what happened to him. Man, and we are having a good old time. And it's been 40 years and more. And it's not going to stop. Because if God gave his son, glory be to God, God would take care of us in this lifetime. Okay, let's pray. Okay, if you're here tonight, you don't have Jesus, that's the thing you got to do. Come on. Don't let fear stop you. Don't let your guilt or your worries or your past or any chain on your ankle or wrist or any people around you with the doors bolted shut. And all the angels saying, Peter, come on, follow me. you are free. It was so amazing. Peter didn't even know if it was a dream or real, but it was real. And same for you tonight. Your sins are gone, and it's not a dream. It's real. Your sins are washed away by the blood of Jesus. Your name is written. Remember, Pontius Pilate said, when he put over the head of Christ on the cross in Latin, Greek, and Hebrew, the King of the Jews, and they said, take that down. He is not the king. And Pilate said, what I have written, I have written. And listen, when God writes your name in the book of life, it is written. And what God has written, it is written. More so even than what Pilate would say. It's written eternally in your name. Yeah, your name. Come to him by faith. Believe in him. Say, Jesus, I believe in you. Raise your hand if you're saying the prayer. The ushers will give you a booklet. We can talk to you after. We want to encourage you. You can do it all by yourself without telling anybody. It's much better. For if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you shall be saved. It's much better to share your faith. Actually, you have to say, I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Say it right now. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you just do that tonight in Jesus' name, and you're saved by God's grace. And grow in it, walk in it, enjoy him. He loves you, and he's the answer for your life. In his name, amen.
Right, before we sing, Janine, are you here? Where's Janine? Janine is going to Istanbul for a couple of weeks. So she's going to a place in the news, so Istanbul. So we just want, you guys want to pray for her protection and just her covering on her time there.
What has become of Janine? Okay, let's stand and pray. Father, thank you for Janine and what has become of Janine. She's in Istanbul. And we're thankful. Just protect her, guide her, lead her, use her, build her. And just may she minister to you, Jesus, in Acts 13, and then to Pastor Roger and his wife, and then to the people of Turkey. We pray and thank you. Cover her. Thank you, God, for giving her within her heart a purpose that's eternal. So touch her in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
The first Noel, the angels did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping on a cold winter's night that was so deep. Noel, 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 Noel. Born is the King of Israel.
Pray together. Father, thank you just for your presence here tonight. And Lord, if we indeed need a good smote in the side, give it to us. But again, Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus and said, "Awakest thou that sleepest, rise from the dead. Christ shall give you light." And Lord, we just thank you for being with us tonight, being here with us tonight, ministering to our hearts. And Lord, there are many, many souls that need to be delivered, many, many souls that need to be set free, many souls that need the chains to fall off. Lead us to them, Lord. Put this message in our hearts to give to them and bring freedom to the captivity. Bring freedom to their hearts. Heal the brokenhearted and open the eyes of those that are spiritually blind. We believe that you're going to do that in the days that lie ahead as we prepare our hearts to enter a new year with new opportunities and that power that you have given us. For the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is able to quicken us and quicken our mortal bodies. We thank you for tonight. Bless your people and those that are traveling. Cover them, protect them supernaturally, free from any atmospheric disturbances, accidents on the roads. Keep your people safe. Bring us back here Friday evening, Lord, for that Christmas Eve the day before Christmas Eve service and just, again, minister to our hearts. We love you. We thank you. We praise your holy name. And thank you, Lord, as we just sang, that blood that bought mankind. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We ask all of this in your name. Amen. You are dismissed.